of like skiing or snowboarding.
Oh, right.
A lot, which is in the mountains.
Yes. Okay, so I was right.
Skiing or snowboarding would be, you know. And I'm back. All right, 10 miles today. Nice and easy after two big days back to back. 10 miles, 16 kilometers. Whew, 520 per kilometer or 840 per mile. So solid day. Let the recovery begin immediately. I mean, really, if you think about it, the running really continues once you're done running, meaning recovery begins. Boom, we're gonna go with Cure, and yes, really enjoying this Unibed recovery mix, endurance fuel. So anyway, that's what I'm putting into my body every single day after the runs at this point in the stage with 100 plus mile training week on tap for this week. So it's pretty serious right now. So as we get going here, today's vlog is all about answering your questions, as many as possible. I'm just gonna dive in. Here we go, Christian. Shout out to Christian. Thank you for the question. He says, hey Seth, wanted to ask you, I see you demo new sneakers every other vlog on YouTube, but do you break in these new kicks by walking around in them? Or do you just run short mileage to break them in? Possible topic of your next vlog or question of the day. Chris, great question. Here we go. Basically, I do not break them in by walking around, but when I was in high school 20 years ago, I did, because I was running more so in Asics a lot actually in high school, and I think you needed to break in shoes more so back in the day. I think in 2019, shoes are becoming a little more nimble right out of the box, meaning the midsole is not quite as, it's more cushioned basically. Same with the uppers as well. So I do not break them in. It's not a bad idea, but for neutral shoes especially, Nike, quite a few New Balance, I just don't think you have to do it as much in the modern era. Now, probably there are some stability shoes, actually like the Ultra Paradigms, they just felt really stiff. I feel like the more you walk around in those, that would be a good idea. But anyway, good question, Christian. I do not walk around in them to break them in, but I would not go out and go run a race with fresh shoes right out of the box. Like, you don't wanna do that. I always break in, meaning maybe one or two jogs in my racing shoes before race day, just to make sure there's no hiccups on race day. Good question, all right. Many more to come. All right, heading out to the post office, run some errands. Gonna keep answering your questions. Next one up, all about the shoe drop. All right, Edward, questions are rolling in hot, rolling in. This is from Malcolm on Facebook. Thank you, Malcolm, for watching. I believe you're from the UK. He asks, hi, Seth, not sure if you've discussed it previously, but it would be interesting to get your thoughts on drops in running shoes. You seem to be able to switch between zero drop shoes to reasonable drop quite easily. There's a lot of talk about injury risk and form difference. So good to know if you are wary of switching between styles. All the best, Malcolm. Malcolm, you're in luck, and I think I already gave you this vlog. I actually made a vlog all about the drop in running shoes for you to go watch. I'll link to it upper right hand corner if you really want to go in depth. I'll give you a concise answer right now. First of all, the drop in a running shoe, for those that don't know, is the stack height of the forefoot subtracted from the stack height of the heel. This is the Turbo 2 from Nike. I believe it's an 8 millimeter drop, and I think it's 28. Oh boy, maybe 30 and 22 or 28 and 20. So that means it's an 8 millimeter drop in this shoe. And Malcolm is wondering if I'm worried about getting injured or it messing with my form. And Malcolm, I am not. I approach zero drop running shoes especially, and we're off to the post office by the way. I'm using zero drop shoes to stretch out my soleus and my calf muscles on easy days. That's how I approach zero drop shoes. I don't race in zero drop. It's just, I actually think a higher drop, so like 8 millimeter and above, helps me run faster. I really think it helps me get up on my toes because it's relieving some of the drop, some of the, the drop of your heel down to the ground. So anyway, and as far as changing my form, man, I mean, oh, that's a tough one. That's a tough one, Malcolm. I don't know. I don't think it does. And again, for zero drop, I'm running usually pretty easy days, slow days, recovery days. We're talking 8 minute pace, 8:30 pace, 9 minute pace, et cetera, et cetera. So good question, Malcolm. All right. Oh, go in, if you want to go in depth, again, upper right hand corner. All right, we're off to this post office, checking the P.O. box. Boom. All right, first question to come in from Twitter. I actually have to get out of the car in 1 second, is from Stuart. Shout out to Stuart on Twitter. What's your all-time favorite running shoe? Oh, Stuart, you had to go there? You had to go there? Oh, man. Jeez, Stuart, what are you doing to me? Okay, let me think for a second. All right. I might have to go with the Salomon Speed Cross lineup. That's a really hard question, Stuart. You put me in a corner, but I'm not afraid to answer, okay? We'll go with the Salomon Speed Cross lineup for aggressive trail running. Pull up, all right. And we made it back from the emissions test. We passed. All right, I have a bowl here because I'm about to make my salad for the day with some good protein, some good meat, some eggs, hard-boiled eggs. I'll pull it out here in a minute. Popeye, he was right. But because of that, I'm going to answer a question right now about fueling from Sam on Twitter. Thank you, Sam, for this question. I'm gonna give it a little thumbs up there. How many carbs or calories do you intake during a long run, 20 plus miles? That is from Sam. Sam, I don't take in very many, frankly. Basically, for a long run, Sam, in case you don't know, I am a ultra runner that's trying to transition down to the marathon. So I'm pretty used to, over the past 3 or 4 years, training for 3 hours, 4 hours, 5 hours, like long runs up in the mountains. And I have found, Sam and everybody else, that when I am running past, I'm gonna call it like 23 miles, that is when I really start to need to take in more fuel, take in more calories. Under 20, it's like almost, even in 50K races, which is 31 miles, it's almost to a T, right around that 23 mile mark, which is a tell for the Amsterdam Marathon. I need to prep myself mentally and how many calories I'm taking in Amsterdam for that 23 mile mark. It's almost like it's right around there. So to answer your question, Sam, I don't take any gels. I would recommend that though. I would, but for me, I don't really need them, okay? But I would recommend 2 gels for a 20 mile long run, especially if you are out there for 3 hours. Let's call it about 3 hours of running or time on your feet. Now I am testing out this Noon Hydration Endurance Mix, which is mixed in with 16 fluid ounces or 500 milliliters of water, is 60 calories. And that is about all I will drink in a long run, okay? And I know that's a little strange, I would always err on the side of more calories and more carbs during your long run, but that's just what I do, and I'm just being honest with, like, that's what I do. But again, 23 miles, I will take in more, maybe a gel, maybe. And one last point on fueling in a long run, don't hesitate to just drink straight water. I have found like just some like 1 or 2 swigs of straight water with no mixes or no gels or no nut, just water. It can really, for me, it really refreshes the body. I don't know what it is, but it's like sometimes I just need hydration, H2O, rather than something that is mixed. So I will keep that in mind as well at the aid stations in Amsterdam. It's a balance, right? Everything is a balance in this world, it seems like. All right, making my salad here. Do-do-do-do.
She's waiting for the hummingbirds to fly by. Sitting peacefully.
All right, everyone, we got our salad here. And yes, if you're wondering why it's a little quiet in the house, the boys are with Nana. So that's what's going on. So I'm gonna answer some more questions right now as I eat my salad here on Twitter, and I'm gonna go a little more rapid fire. Here we go. This is from Maj on Twitter. I like training on dirt roads, but my marathon race is on the roads. Will this have a huge impact when race day approaches? Maj, you might be a little more, you'll be a lot more sore most likely after the race, but frankly, how I approach it is that training on dirt is loose, meaning it's, you know, your footing is not gonna be as solid. So when you get on pavement, you're gonna fly. You're just gonna fly, like your grip is gonna be better. You're not gonna lose, frankly, you shouldn't lose, depending on your shoe condition, but you shouldn't lose as much traction and sliding. It's very small, but anyway, Maj, my opinion is that you're safer, and that was my bad for Cleveland, is that I trained too much on the roads and got an injury. So anyway, good question. All right, moving on, here we go. I'm gonna save that one for true love in a minute. And this is from Goseki. He asked, what evidence have you seen that stretching before exercise reduces your performance? Is it something that you have looked into? And I've heard of that. I haven't done much research on that. I don't buy it. Just off the, you know, I've never experienced poor. That is such a subjective or object. No, yeah, subjective point of view that I can't even go there, Goseki. So I don't buy it. I don't buy it. All right, moving on here. What shoe would you? This is from Benjo on Twitter. What shoe would you recommend for my first marathon next spring? He loves his Pegasus and Beacons, but not sure they'll be up to that sort of distance. Something comfortable and light for a very average runner looking around the 4-hour mark. That's from Benjo on Twitter. I would recommend looking at the, I know it's crazy now, it wouldn't be my first choice for me, but Ben, I'm thinking the Hoka Rincons. They're lightweight. I feel like they have some good snap and good cushion, so your legs won't be totally destroyed at the end of the marathon. Also, if you want something a little more responsive, a little more giddy up in your gait cycle, I would look at the New Balance Fuel Cell Rebel. So those would be my two shoes that jump to mind immediately. Good question. Moving on here. Do you think or worry about, this is from James on Twitter, do you think or worry about your 5K speed and its conversion to your marathon goal? To an extent, there is a correlation, right? There is a correlation to leg speed and goal. Yeah, there's definitely a correlation to your leg speed and your marathon goal. Am I worried about my 5K speed and its conversion? James, I am not. Only because, James, I think at the end of the day, your engine inside trumps your leg speed. So how your body is able to process, bring in oxygen through your lungs, and then pass that oxygen into your red blood cells, which is then distributed out to your muscles. I think, and that is why I spend so much time in the mountains at high altitude. And as the saying goes, hill work is speed work in disguise. I do believe that at this point in my, after training so much in the mountains, that, but I will say, James, it is key to sharpen and make sure your legs can, and that's why I'm doing a tempo run on Sunday and then a threshold run on Wednesday to get that turnover going. That's why the forearm drills, the plyometrics, all of that, strides, it all adds up. But I'm more in the camp of it's all in here versus here on with respect to hitting your goal times. Oh my gosh. All right, I got to move on, James. Good question. If you want to hear more of my thoughts, the How to Run Faster training playlist is right upper right hand corner. Moving on. Oh boy. I'm gonna save that one for true love as well. Okay, I think I got through all of them on Twitter. Let me just make sure. Okay, I did. Okay. Time for salad. Love you. Oh man, you guys get me going. I don't know about all you, but I could eat chips and salsa for dessert every night. I just could. That's it. It's just how I roll. Chips and salsa. It's like my go-to. It is my go-to. Oh man, so tasty. Okay, we're gonna take one more question from Twitter, and then we're gonna switch over to Instagram. So just trying to hit them all, and I think this question fits well because I am going to massage right now with this new foam roller, and it comes from Steve on Twitter. So he asks, any experience using a Theragun? So in case you don't know what that is, and I'm gonna get this going, a Theragun is a massaging tool, I'll just call it that turns on kind of like this. And it basically, you hold it, it almost looks like a drill that you would use to drill in a screw in your house or wherever. And it basically pulsates up and down into your muscle. And Steve, to answer your question, I have used a Theragun after races, but I do not own one. So I've probably used it 3 or 4 times before. And I think Theraguns would be great for digging into, like, if you have a bad cramp or a pulled muscle, gentle at first. Of course, I think it's a little different. I prefer this foam roller because it gets more general massaging rather than like a direct area. If you pulled some, like a pulled your calf, I could really see a Theragun working well. But Steve, I guess to answer your question, I do have experience, but just not a ton. So, all right, we'll leave it at that. I don't know about you, but I think for Halloween, I'm gonna go as a runner, right? Fitting the part. No fashion contest in these here parts. No siree, Bob. All right, studio time. So what we're gonna do here in the studio is go live on Instagram. And then all the questions that I'm unable to answer live will end up, well, right here in the vlog. That's where you're at. So let me get this camera set up and the light. All right, cameras are set. Let me just hit Instagram here. Go live. Oh boy, checking connection. You're now live. Hello, everybody. Let's just wait for some people to show up. So welcome. There we go. A couple people here. Oh, good to see you. I see you, bud. I see you. So today's, everyone that's watching, tomorrow's vlog is going to be a Q&A. So I'm gonna answer as many questions from all of you as possible here in the studio. And yes, I have the camera going right now recording. So if I don't get to your questions, I will do my best to answer them for tomorrow's vlog. So what questions do you have for me? If it's about running shoes, that's great. If it's about running, that's great. But you can ask me anything. So hit it up in the comments. I will do my best. Thanks, Josh, David, Maya. Studio K in the house. It's good to see everyone. So again, ask any questions you want and I will answer. And yes, again, I'm recording here. Studio's looking good. Here we go. I'm just waiting for it. Oh, you know what? There it is. Boom. I got an answer there. Favorite road shoe right now. That's from Bali's. Let's see. Favorite road shoe right now. It's actually, oh, good question. Good question. I'm going to have to go with, man, it's a toss up between the New Balance Fuel Cell Rebel and probably the Nike Zoom Fly 3. Okay, good question from Bali's. Thank you for asking. And it's a tough one, but I'm gonna go with Fuel Cell Rebel or the Nike Zoom Fly 3. Okay, what else? How do you move on from a bad day of running? That's from David. Well, David, there's so many days is how I approach it. And like one day is such a small drop in the ocean compared to just think of 1 year of training. And that's the beauty of distance running. It's a long-term proposition. Your aerobic development, like that's why the best marathon runners in the world peak when they're in their 30s, 32, 33, 30. Kipchoge, who's gonna try and break 2 hours, he's 34 years old. So one day is just a little blip in the ocean compared to the overall lifetime of training. Good question from David. Let's see here, make sure I'm not missing any questions from there. Okay, so Hudson asks, favorite high school cross country memory? Man, Hudson, that's a good one, man. Oh, favorite high school. I mean, honestly, Hudson, it's probably the camaraderie, like having team dinners together, you know, traveling on the bus together. I wish I could say maybe it was like a racing memory, but we did take second place as a high school, as a team in the entire state my senior year. So we were gunning for that championship, didn't quite happen. So anyway, that'd be my answer to that. Good question from Hudson. Let's see. And let me just make sure. So this is from Yay Romero. He asks, as a high school cross country runner, is it okay to take days off before a race? I'm a sub 17 minute runner, if that helps with the question. Man, absolutely. Like one day, no problem. 2 days, no problem. I would say if you start talking about 3 or 4 days, it might mean your legs are overtired or you're overtrained. I probably wouldn't take more than 2 days off leading into a race. And if you could just get out there and maybe you just need to walk and stretch. But no, you're not gonna lose any fitness in 2 days, absolutely not. So don't hesitate. Or maybe you go to the pool and you do some aqua jogging. That's another good option if you have access to a pool. All right, good question. Let's just see here. Oh man, so many coming in. Let's see. Grant asks, and I'm not a doctor, Grant, but I'll do my best. Can't seem to get past some intense shin splints. Any advice? Well, and that is from Grant. Gosh, Grant, I would say Oh, there's a stretching vlog I made a couple weeks ago, or no, 10 days ago. I would recommend going and watching that. It's the anterior tibialis stretch. And basically you sit in a chair and you cross one leg over, the leg that's hurting with the shin splints, you cross your leg over and you're sitting in a chair, and then you pull your foot toward your chest gently and you'll stretch the outside of your shin, I think, really, really well. Again, go to a doctor, not a doctor. Good question, Grant. I hope that helps. Moving on here, next, I'm trying to get in as many as possible. Running my first trail 50K tomorrow. Any last minute advice? That's from the real Michael Clinton. Thank you, Michael, for being here. Okay, first trail 50K tomorrow. I don't know the vertical, and that actually makes a big difference in trail running. I'm guessing there is some vertical built in because it's on the trails. So I'm gonna say, Michael, that I would, it's easy to say, like, go out conservative, go out a little slower. That's never bad advice in a 50K. I'm gonna say make sure you really pay attention to fueling at the aid stations. Not too much, but don't just run through the aid stations, okay? Make sure you're getting enough, because especially when you get to 23 miles and above, that's when I have found in 50K races where my legs and my body start to tell me, okay, this is really, really hurting. So don't forego the aid stations. Anyway, I'll leave it there. Good question. Okay, let's see. Moving on here. Is the Nike Pegasus Turbo 2, which is right here, is the Nike Pegasus Turbo 2 good for 5 or 10K racing? Yes, absolutely. Would it be my first choice? No. I would lean toward this shoe more for a 10K or a half marathon. I think there are lighter options out there for a 5K, but that's a great question. I would race in this for a 10K and a half marathon. Again, it would be a tough decision actually for me between the New Balance Fuel Cell Rebel and the Turbo 2. And that ZoomX foam though, you can't beat it. So listen, there's always probably gonna be a faster option out there for road racing, but you have to ask yourself about the price point. Are you start talking about these carbon fiber plate shoes and they start to get a little pricey. So anyway, good question. I hope that helps. Dinesh, I believe it is. So moving on. And yes, I don't actually know how long I'm allowed to stay live on Instagram, so it might cut us off here in a minute. And I think it's like, is it 5 minutes, 10 minutes? Does anybody know? Okay. Let's see, moving on here. I'm just trying to find here. This is from Birdman. Have you tried running in the same shoes as Joe Gray wears when racing? That's awesome. No, I actually think, here they are. Oh man, I'm glad I have these right here. The Salomon S-Lab Sense 7 SG. So Joe is sponsored by Hoka, and I believe it's the Hoka, oh my gosh, what is the name of, Jaws, there it is. The Hoka Jaws, spelled J-A-W-Z. I think I've seen him race in those. So this, I would take this shoe over a Hoka trail racing shoe any day with respect to shorter distances. I think Hoka is nailing it when it comes to longer distances, like the Hoka Evo Speed Goat. Great shoe for a 50 miler or a 100 miler. But as far as under 20 miles, under 15 miles, I would take this Salomon S-Lab Sense 7 SG any day. It's just so lightweight. And yeah, so hope that helps. Okay, moving on. Oh my God, I cannot keep up. There's so many. Okay, Yuchu Kuran. Let's see, he says, since it's almost Amsterdam Marathon, how many speed sessions per week are you doing? And what type of speed work are you doing? Thanks, James. So I'm not doing hardly any speed work. If you've been watching the channel a long time, you know how I believe in a little more aerobic development versus anaerobic development. Now, I love tempo runs, I love threshold runs, but speed work or interval training, I put into the category of going into oxygen debt, which in a marathon race, you want to walk that line. You don't really want to go into oxygen debt, especially early in the race. If you go into oxygen debt the first 3 miles, the first 10 miles, even the first half marathon, you're going to blow up and you're going to slow down because your body cannot deliver enough oxygen to your muscles. So I emphasize and focus more on developing the aerobic side, the side of breathing that is not in oxygen debt. But I will do I'm basically 2 to 3 sessions of speed work before Amsterdam. It's just not quite time yet. We're about 4.5 weeks out, a little less than 4.5 weeks out. So good question. I hope that helps. Oh man. Let's see here. So many great people here. Tom is here. Bradley, Seth, another Seth. What's up? Scott's here. Peter's here. So good to see everyone. So let me just take, I'll take two more. How about two more questions and then we will call it there. James asks, any advice on getting an IT band sorted out? I have been getting treatment, but still very sore. Oh man, sorry, James. I've had IT band issues once in my life, back in high school. And massage is good, stretching is good. From the research that I've done, you wanna make sure that you're stretching all of the muscles around your IT band, so all those quadriceps, you know, your hamstring, your glutes. Getting a massage though, and especially if your massage therapist really knows what they're doing, that can really help as well. James, sorry, I actually don't have a lot of experience with IT band issues. Now, for me, I'll just say it, I'm not afraid to say it. Now, talk to your doctor. I'm not afraid to foam roll really close to the IT band, if not right on it. Again, that's just what I do because I've been doing it for so long. So again, always talk to your doctor. Oh man, okay, one more. Who's it gonna be? Let's see. Preston says, no question, just wanted to say I just finished a 10-mile trail run and that your videos are motivating me day in and day out. You're awesome. Oh, Preston, you rock. Thanks for being here. Let's see. Okay. So I'm going to go with, I'm trying to find one more, everyone. Thank you for your patience. Thanks for being here. Oh, man. All right. I'm waiting for one. Let's see. Connor's training for London. I run for fun. Says, are you going to be in Greeley again soon? I am not. Maybe for the turkey trot. We'll see. Let's see. Okay, there we go. We'll take that one. Best daily trainers for long distance road runners. Oh man, best daily trainers for long distance road runners. Here's the deal. As you can see around me, there's so many options out there for different shoes for you to consider. So like it depends, are you training on concrete and pavement more? Are you doing a mix of dirt and pavement? That's what I do a lot here in Denver. Road daily trainers, for an affordable option, the Nike Pegasus 36, I think is a great option. Man, I'm just looking around trying to rack my brain. Actually, I would say that I think the Nike Zoomfly 3, now it's a little more expensive, and this is, you know, I would use this definitely for tempo runs, but if you want a shoe that can go fast and you could use for daily training, this could definitely be an option for you. Oh man, all right, everyone, thank you for being here. Thanks for tuning in here live in the studio. Love you guys, you guys rock, and signing off. See ya. All right, I think that does it for out here in the studio. We're going to go inside, ask a few more questions with true love. Let's go. Come on. All right, true love. We got some questions from the fans here. We got some questions. True love in the house. Hi, hi.
Hi, baby.
We need more true love in the vlog. We need more true love in the vlog. Okay, actually, let me just make sure there's the mic. So okay. Make sure everyone can hear us. All right, this is test one. It's from Nick on Twitter. He asks, and these are a little, you know, kind of family related.
Okay.
In the future, will you encourage your sons to run cross country?
Yep. Yes.
We're not football players.
No, protect. I love my brain. Listen, they already love running. They are natural runners. You should see them. They have his cadence. They have his strength. They have his form. I mean, remember Sethy? But he was like, he had just learned how to walk. He was almost two, 1.5, 2. And he was running up and down the beach of Wellington Lake.
Yeah.
And everyone was dang, that guy's gonna be a runner.
I think opening opportunities for them. Like, I think it's gonna come natural. That's what happened with me and my dad. That you just go to races and you see how much fun it is and you wanna do it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So
that's what they'll have known.
Yeah.
If they wanna do something else, that's okay. No wrestling, no football. But other than that,
you know. All right, moving on to the last one here from Twitter. This is from Boy Fiery, or no, Yummy Elephants. If you weren't a runner, and I'm gonna ask,
funny name.
If you weren't a runner, what other sport or hobby would you have? So I'm gonna, would I have one in my mind? What would you, if you had to guess one for me?
You would read more books.
I would read
but
more books.
But what other sports or hobbies?
Yeah, what other sport or hobby would you have for me, you know, if you had to, if you were,
I would say like probably something still in the mountains, like mountain climbing or something rugged, mountain biking.
Yeah. Oh, I just don't even like to think about that option.
Soccer. No, I don't know.
I think it would be something along the lines of like skiing or snowboarding.
Oh, right.
A lot, which is in the mountains.
Yes. Okay, so I was right.
Skiing or snowboarding would be, you know, like in the wintertime. In the summertime.
Skateboarding?
You know, it would probably be, I used to love basketball.
I remember that.
I used to love basketball. I thought I was going to be the next Muggsy Bogues. Remember him? He's the shortest basketball player in NBA history.
He would have been good.
That didn't pan out. But
that didn't pan out. This did, though.
Boom. Yeah, that's right. That's right. So that is a vlog, everyone. We are calling it. Can you believe it?
Wow.
I know. Oh, question of the day.
This was easy.
Question of the day. Question of the day. I guess, well, do you have one?
Okay, you're runners. If you weren't a runner, what sport or hobby would you pick up?
Boom.
Do sport and hobby, because in my mind, hobby is more like sitting down and reading a book.
Yeah.
With a Bloody
so
Mary.
Sport or hobby?
Yeah.
Okay. With a Bloody Mary. So that's the question of the day. If you weren't a runner, what other sport or hobby
it
would you
look? Didn't exist.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah.
That's a good
what
one.
What would you do?
All right. All right. All right. We're going to throw it back to a few old vlogs. Actually, we're going to do one vlog on the right from, we're going to do an old Solomon running shoe vlog. And then on the left, we're going to go back to an old live stream where I answered more questions. All right.
Those were really good.
So, all right, everyone. Seek beauty.
Work hard.
And love each other.
See you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow.